So there are two sections here that I want to read. The first is the opening section where, you know, I pretty much lay out the mission of the book, and it's all about fear and what it means to grow up under fear. And the second section is about the summer that my son, my wife, and me spent here in Paris. In fact, I came into the library in 2013 during that summer. And I should add that, you know, every time I come here and every time I'm in Paris in general, but every time I'm here, it's not, you know, it is not outside of the creative process. It becomes a part of the creative process. And so that, I think, is in the second part of this piece. So, wow, no more delaying. I'm going to go ahead and get started. This is from my book, which will come out October 17th, Between the World and Me. Very excited to read this here. Son. Last Sunday, the host of a popular news show asked me what it meant to lose my body. I was appearing on a well-regarded news program. I was seated in a studio on the far west side of Manhattan. There was a cord coming out of my ear and another dangling from my shirt. Someone had applied makeup to my face. I saw the screen cut away from the host and words which I had written that week scroll by. The host read these words for the audience, and when she finished, she turned to the loss of my body. She did not mention my body specifically, but by now I am accustomed to intelligent people asking about the condition of my body without realizing the nature of their request. Specifically, the host wished to know why I felt, as I had recently claimed, that white America's progress was built on looting and violence. Hearing this, an old and indistinct sadness welled up in me. The answer to this question, as you have likely gleaned by now, is the record of white America itself. There is nothing extreme in this statement. Americans are believers in what the historian Barbara Fields has helpfully dubbed racecraft. That is to say, they believe race to be the creation of physical law, and thus cousin to gravity, inertia, or the curvature of the earth. American racism is thus considered a natural byproduct and an unfortunate side effect of an unalterable condition. In this way, a great crime is covered in the innocence of science. But race flows from racism, not the other way around. And white America has never been so much a matter of genealogy and physiognomy as hierarchy. Differences in hue and hair are old, but the belief in the preeminence of hue and hair, the notion that these factors can correctly organize a society, that they grant deeper attributes which are indelible, this is the new idea at the heart of these new people who have been brought up hopelessly, tragically, deceitfully, to believe that they are white. These new people have not spread their new belief nor achieved their new prominence through wine tastings and ice cream socials, but through the pillaging of life, liberty, labor, and land, through the flaying of backs, the chaining of limbs, the strangling of dissidents, the destruction of families, the rape of mothers, the sale of children, and various other acts meant first and foremost to deny you and I the right to secure and govern our own bodies. The new people are not original in this. Perhaps there is a great power whose elevation is exempt from the violent exploitation of other human bodies. If there is, I have yet to encounter it. But this banality of violence can never excuse America because America makes no claims to the banal. Indeed, we believe ourselves to be uniquely called to the work of democracy and thus large among all nations across time and space. We would do well to take this claim seriously. And this is difficult because all around us there is an entire apparatus urging us to accept our world at face value and not inquire too much. And it is too easy to look away, to think mainly of Pop-Tarts and Frosted Flakes, to obsess over Blu-rays and ski trips, to live among the magnificent telephones and wondrous applications, and in so doing, ignore the great evil done in all of our name. But you and I have never had that luxury. I think you know. I write you in your 14th year. I write you because you saw Eric Garner choked to death for selling cigarettes, and you know that Renisha McBride was shot for seeking help, that John Crawford was shot down for browsing in a department store, and you have seen men drive by and murder Tamir Rice, an 11-year-old child whom they were oath-bound to protect, and you have seen these same men pummel someone's grandma on the side of a thoroughfare in California. And you must know that the police departments of your country have been endowed with the power to destroy your body. It does not matter if the destruction of your body was an unfortunate overreaction. It does not matter that the destruction of your body originates in a misunderstanding. It does not matter if the destruction of your body springs from foolish policy. Sell cigarettes without the proper authority and your body can be destroyed. Resent the people trying to entrap your body and it can be destroyed. Turn into a dark stairwell and your body can be destroyed. The destroyers of your body will rarely be held accountable. Mostly they will receive pensions. And destruction is merely the superlative dominion whose prerogatives include friskings, detainings, beatings, and humiliations. All of this is common to black people. All of this is old for black people. No one is held responsible. The body of Michael Brown was left in the middle of the street for 4 hours. It cannot be expected that anyone will be held responsible. And there is nothing uniquely evil in the destroyers of your body, for they are merely men enforcing the whims of your country and correctly interpreting its heritage and legacy. This legacy aims toward the shackling of your body. It is hard to face this, but all of our phrasing, race relations, racial chasm, racial justice, racial profiling, white privilege, even white supremacy, obscure the fact that racism is a visceral experience, that it dislodges brains, blocks airways, rips anuses, knocks out teeth, extracts testicles, disembowels. Last Sunday, I tried to explain this as best I could within the time allotted. But at the end of the segment, the host flashed a much-dispensed picture of an 11-year-old black boy tearfully clutching the midriff of a white police officer and then asked about hope. And I knew then that I had failed. And I remembered that I had, in fact, expected to fail. And I wondered at the indistinct sadness welling in me. Why was I sad? I came out of that studio and walked for a while. It was a calm December day. Families believing themselves white were out on the street. Infants raised to be white were bundled in strollers. And I was sad for these people, much as I was sad for the hosts and sad for all the people out there watching and reveling in an unearned hope. I realized then why I was sad. When the journalist asked me about my body, it was like she was asking me to awaken her from the most gorgeous dream. I have seen that dream all my life. It is modest houses with nice lawns. It is Memorial Day cookouts, block associations, and driveways. The dream is tree houses and Cub Scouts. The dream smells like peppermint but tastes like strawberry shortcake. And I have wanted so long to escape into that dream, to fold my country over my head like a blanket, until all the bad things are vanquished by magic. But this has never been an option, because the fact is the dream is built on us, because the bedding was made from our bodies. And knowing this, and knowing that the dream, is an escape, and is not the actual world, I was sad for the host, I was sad for all of these families, I was sad for my country, but above all, I was sad for you. That was the week you learned that the killer of Michael Brown, that the men who left his body in the street like some awesome declaration of their inviolable power, would go unpunished. I had known that these men would go unpunished from the moment I heard Michael Brown's name. But you were young and still believed. And the dream is so lovely. You stayed up waiting for the announcement of an indictment. And when there was none, you said, "I've got to go." And you went into your room and I heard you crying. I came in 5 minutes after and I did not hug you and I did not comfort you because I thought it would be wrong to comfort you. I did not tell you it would be okay because I have never believed it would be okay. What I told you is what your grandparents endeavored to tell me. I told you that this was your country, that this was your world, that this is your body, and you must find some way to live within this world and within that body. I tell you, this is the question of how one should live within a black body, and it is the question of my life, and the pursuit of this question I have found ultimately answers the question itself. This must seem strange to you. We live in a goals-oriented era. Our published vocabulary are full of hot takes, big ideas, actionable solutions, and grand theories of everything. But some time ago, I rejected magic in all its forms, and I accepted that I would die. This was not a retreat into cynicism. When I say that I accepted I would die, I mean that I was freed from any consideration of second lives and preordained justice. And in accepting the fact of my total end, I was free to truly consider how I wish to live. When I look back, I see that I have always been asking a profound version of this question, perhaps the most profound version. How do I live free in this body? It is profound because America fashions itself as the work of the divine, and the black body is the clearest evidence that it is the work of men. I have asked this question through my readings and my writings, through the music of my youth, through arguments with your grandfather, with your mother, with your Aunt Janae, with your Uncle Ben. I was asking it when I thought about you and the reasons I wanted you to be. The question is unanswerable, which is not to say futile. The greatest reward of this constant interrogation, of confrontation with the brutality of my country, is that it has freed me from the ghosts and the myths and girded me against the sheer terror of disembodiment. And I am very afraid. I feel this fear most acutely whenever you leave me. But I was afraid long before you, and in this I was unoriginal. When I was your age, the only people I knew were black, and all of them were powerfully, adamantly, dangerously afraid. I had seen this fear evidenced all my young life, though I had not always recognized it as such. I had seen it in the extravagant boys of my neighborhood in their large rings and medallions, in their big puffy coats and full-length fur-collared leathers, which was their armor against the world. It was always right in front of me. They would stand on the corner of Gwin Oak and Liberty or Cold Spring and Park Heights or outside of Mondawmin Mall with their hands dipped in their Russell sweats. I think back on these boys now and all I see is fear, and all I see is them girding themselves against the ghosts of the bad old days when the Mississippi mobs gathered around their grandfathers so that the branches of the black body might be torched and cut away. The fear lived on in their practice bop, in their slouching denim, in their big t-shirts, in the calculated angle of their baseball caps, a whole catalog of behaviors and garments enlisted to inspire the belief that these boys were in firm possession of everything they desired. I saw it in all their rituals of war. I was no older than 5, sitting out on my porch on Woodbrook Avenue, watching 2 shirtless boys circle each other close and buck shoulders. From then on, I knew that there was a ritual to a street fight. Bylaws and codes which in their very need attested to all the vulnerability of black teenage bodies. I heard the fear in the first music I ever knew, the music that pumped from boom boxes full of carnal boasts and messianic destiny. The boys who stood out on Garrison and Liberty up on Park Heights loved this music because it told them against all evidence and odds that they truly were masters of all they surveyed. I saw it in the girls, in their loud laughter, in their gilded bamboo earrings, which announced their names 3 times over. And I saw it in their brutal language and hard gaze, how they would cut you with their eyes, destroy you with their words, all for the sin of playing too much. "Keep my name out your mouth," they would say. I would watch them after school, how they squared off like boxers, Vaseline'd up, earrings off, Reeboks on, and leapt at each other. I felt the fear in my visits to my Nana's home in Philadelphia. You never knew her. I barely knew her myself. But what I remember is her hard manner, her rough voice. And I remember her man and his odd name, Grandpa Wally, which nodded to the void where your great-grandfather should have been. But I knew that my father's father was dead, and that my Uncle Oscar was dead, and that my Uncle David was dead, and that each of these instances were unnatural. And I saw it in my own father, who loves you, who counsels you, who slipped me money to care for you when your mother and I had no idea. Dad was so very afraid. I felt it in the sting of his black leather belt, which he applied with more anxiety than anger. My father, who beat me like someone might steal me away, because that is exactly what was happening all around us. Everyone had a lost child, somehow, to the streets. It was said that these lost girls were sweet as honey and would not hurt a fly. It was said that these lost boys had just received a GED and had begun to turn their lives around. Now they were gone, and their legacy was a great fear. Perhaps you already know. Perhaps it has already come to you. It came to me when I was somewhat younger, most outrageously. I was 11 years old, standing out in the parking lot in front of a 7-Eleven, watching a crew of older boys standing near the streets. They yelled and gestured at who? Another boy, young like me, who stood there almost smiling, gamely throwing up his hands. The boy had lost his body a long time ago, and he knew it. Who knows what brought him to knowledge, the projects, a drunken stepfather, an older brother concussed by the police, a cousin pinned in the city jail. That he was outnumbered did not matter because the whole galaxy had outnumbered him long ago. And this was a war for the possession of his body, and that would be the war of his entire life. I stood there for some seconds, marveling at the older boy's beautiful sense of fashion. They all wore ski jackets, the kind which, in my day, mothers put on layaway in September, then piled up overtime hours so as to have the thing wrapped and ready for Christmas. I focused in on a light-skinned boy with a long head and small eyes, scowling at this other boy who stood close to me. It was just before 3 p.m. I was in the 6th grade. School had just let out, and it was not yet the fighting weather of early spring. What was the exact problem here? Who could know? The boy with the small eyes reached into his ski jacket and pulled out. I recall it in the slowest motion, as though tumbling from a skyscraper into a dream. There the boy stood with the gun brandished, which he slowly untucked, tucked and untucked once more, and in his small eyes I saw a surging rage that could in an instant erase my body. That was 1986. That was the year I felt myself to be drowning in the news reports of murder, and I was aware that these murders very often did not land upon intended targets, but fell upon great aunts, PTA mothers, overtime uncles, and joyful children, fell upon them random and relentless, like great sheets of rain. I knew this in theory, but I could not understand it as fact until the boy with the small eyes stood across from me, holding my entire body in his small hand. The boy with the small eyes did not shoot. His friends pulled him back. He did not need to shoot. He had affirmed our place in the order of things. He had let it be known how easily we could be selected. I took the subway home that day, processing the episode all alone. I did not tell my parents. I did not tell my teachers. And if I told my friends, I would have done so with all the excitement needed to obscure the fear that came over me in that moment. That was the era when I first began to comprehend the captive power of my country. I remember being amazed that death could easily rise up from the nothing of a boyish afternoon and billow up the way like a fog. I knew that West Baltimore, where I lived, that Philadelphia, where my cousins lived, that Chicago, where the friends of my father lived, comprised a world apart from all others. And too, I knew that somewhere out there, beyond the firmament, past the asteroid belt, there were other worlds where children did not regularly fear for their bodies. I knew this because there was a large television set resting in my living room. In the evening, I sat before this television set, bearing witness to the dispatches from the dream. In the dream, there were little boys with complete collections of football cards, and their only wants were popular girls, and their only worry was poison oak. The dream was suburban and endless, was organized around pot roast, blueberry pie, fireworks, ice cream sundaes, immaculate bathrooms, and small toy trucks that were loosed in wooded backyards with streams and glens. Comparing these dispatches with the facts of my native world, I came to understand that my country was a galaxy. And this galaxy stretched from the pandemonium of the West Baltimore of my youth to the happy hunting grounds of Mr. Belvedere. I obsessed over the distance between that other sector of space and my own. I knew that my portion of the American galaxy where bodies were enslaved by a tenacious gravity was black and that the other liberated portion was not. I knew that some inscrutable energy preserved the breach. I felt, but did not yet understand, the relation between the other world and me. And I felt in this cosmic injustice a profound cruelty which infused an abiding, irrepressible desire to unshackle my body and achieve a velocity of escape. So there's a lot that happens. I mean, it's roughly a story. I wrote this memoir, and the memoir ended like in college, and rather unintentionally, it's kind of ended up as like a sequel. Although I think this is a little bit more argumentative and less memoiristic. It starts there, and you know, basically like where the memoir leaves off in West Baltimore, and then it picks up, and you know, I go to college, and when I was in college, there was a young man, and this is like the hard thing about like the Michael Brown thing, and you know, this whole summer, which you know, these whole past few years, which I'm not completely sure there's an increase, you know, in these kinds of killings as much as there's just so much more awareness. Everybody has iPhones and cameras, and people can record stuff, upload it, and you know, it's just sort of out there in a particular way. But my son, you know, he was coming to this awareness, and probably the first time I came to it in a really, really literal way was in college. I had a friend named Prince Jones, and Prince was from a very, very good family, very upwardly mobile African-American family. And shortly after I graduated, after my son was born, he was driving from just a meeting, hanging out with some friends, through Washington, D.C., out into Virginia, which is just south of Washington, D.C., and he was shot there by a police officer who was from Prince George's County, where he had started his journey. And the cop had followed him under the suspicion that he was a criminal. Prince was like the furthest thing from a criminal. And when they went back to investigate it, they tried to find any sort of way by which he might be a criminal that would explain how this guy would be killed. And they didn't really investigate the officer. They investigated my friend. And what they came up with was a born-again Christian whose mom was a radiologist, raised in Opelousas, Louisiana, and had come from dirt poverty and raised herself all the way up, you know, to be this really, really prominent, you know, woman who had sent this kid off to Howard University. And the killer part about it was the mistake was made because he was driving a Jeep, and the Jeep was the same make as the guy who they, you know, had this lead on, they thought was a criminal. The only thing these two people shared was that they just happened to be black males. The guy they were looking for was short and a little overweight. Prince was like, you know, 6'4", and maybe like 180 pounds, not overweight at all. He just happened to be black. And when they ran the license tags on Prince, they got his mother's address because his mother had bought him this Jeep. And I went to talk to this woman about a year ago, you know, just to, you know, hear her story. And it really brought all of this home. And she said, you know, I bought him that Jeep, and that was the Jeep he was killed in. And this, you know, had just a huge, huge impact on me. I actually, you know, in many ways, you know, it's one of the, you know, sort of primary events that shifted, you know, my sense of American history. So, like, to be there with my son and I have to replay this constantly, you know, in these conversations is difficult, as you can imagine. As I was saying, we came here in 2013, and you know, balanced against, you know, this whole notion that I'm trying to establish early in the book of gravity, of your body being captive to history, to society, in a way that you didn't quite create, is this notion of attempting to get out. Is there any actual way to get out? You know, can we get our kids out? You know, can I get out, frankly? And, you know, coming here, you know, for the first time, it was probably like an experiment in trying to get out. With ambiguous results. I mean, in fact, in many ways, I think like the events of the last month kind of clarified that. I mean, it was clear before then, but it really clarified it, you know. What I'm going to read now is just, it's about getting out, you know, and it's about, you know, notions of getting out, my son getting out, and you know, being here in Paris, and the experience of that. And then after that, you know, I'll open up for some questions. Here is how I take the measure of my progress in life. I imagine myself as I was back there in West Baltimore, dodging North and Pulaski, ducking Murphy Holmes, fearful of the schools and the streets, and I imagine showing that lost boy a portrait of my present life and asking him what he would make of it. Only once, in the 2 years after your birth, in the first two rounds of the fight of my life, have I ever believed that I would have been disappointed. I write to you at the precipice of my 40th year, having come to a point in my life not of great prominence, but far beyond anything that boy could have imagined. I did not master the streets because I could not read the body language quick enough. I did not master the schools because I could not see where any of it could possibly lead. But I did not fall. I have my family. I have my work. And godless though I am, the fact of being human, the fact of possessing the gift of study, and thus being remarkable among all matter floating through the cosmos still awes me. I have spent much of my studies searching for for the right question by which I might fully understand the breach between the world and me. Here is how it now occurs to me. Is the umbrella of human rights grand enough to protect all human bodies equally? I have not spent my time studying the problem of race. Race itself is just a restatement and retrenchment of the problem. You see this from time to time when some dullard, usually believing himself to be white, proposes that the way forward is a grand orgy of black and white people, ending only when we are all beige and thus the same race. But a great number of black people are already beige. And the history of civilization is littered with dead races, Frankish, Italian, German, Irish, presently abandoned because they no longer serve their purpose, the organization of people beneath and beyond the umbrella of human rights. If my life ended today, I would tell you it was a happy life, that I drew great joy from this study, from the struggles toward which I now urge you. I write you at the precipice of our 150th year in America, 50 years after they tore Malcolm down. You have seen in this conversation that the struggle has ruptured and remade me several times over in Baltimore, at the Mecca, in fatherhood, in New York. The changes have awarded me a rapture which comes only when you can no longer be lied to, when you have rejected the dream and embraced the world. But more, the changes have taught me how best to exploit that singular gift of study to question what I see, then question what I see after that, because the questions matter as much, perhaps more than, the answers. But oh, my eyes. When I was a boy, no portion of my body suffered more than my eyes. If I have done well by the measure of childhood, it must be added that the measure itself is hampered by how little a boy of my captive class had seen. The dream seemed to be the pinnacle then, to grow rich and live in one of those disconnected houses out in the country, in one of those small communities of cul-de-sacs and gently curving ways where they staged teen movies and children built tree houses, and in that last lost year before college, teenagers made love in cars parked at the lake. The dream seemed to be the end of the world to me, the height of American ambition. What more could possibly exist beyond the dispatches, beyond the suburbs? Your mother knew. Perhaps it was because she was raised within the physical borders of such a place, because she lived in proximity with the dreamers. Perhaps it was because the people who thought they were white told her she was smart and followed this by telling her she was not really black, and they meant this as a compliment. Perhaps it was the boys out there who in fact were black and told her she was pretty for a dark-skinned girl and also meant this as a compliment. Your mother never felt quite at home, and this made the possibility of some other place essential to her, propelling her to the Mecca, propelling her to New York, and then beyond. On her 30th birthday, she took a trip to Paris. I am not sure you remember. You were only 6. We spent that week eating fried fish for breakfast and cake for dinner and leaving our underwear on the counter. It had never occurred to me to leave America, not even temporarily. My eyes. My friend Jelani, who came up in much the same way as me, once said that he used to think of traveling as a pointless luxury, like blowing the rent check on a pink suit. And I felt much the same then. I was bemused at your mother's dreams of Paris. I could not understand them, and I did not think I needed to. Some part of me was still back in that 7th grade French class, thinking only of the immediate security of my body, regarding France as one might regard Jupiter. But now your mother had gone and done it, and when she returned, her eyes were dancing with all the cosmic possibilities out there, not just for her, but for you and for me. It is quite ridiculous how the feeling spread. It was like falling in love. The things which get you are so small. The things which keep you up at night are so particular to you that when you try to explain, the only reward anyone can give you is a dumb, polite nod. Your mother had taken many pictures all through Paris of doors, giant doors, deep blue, ebony, orange, turquoise, and burning red doors. I examined the pictures of these giant doors in our small Harlem apartment. I had never seen anything like them. It had never even occurred to me that such giant doors could exist, could be so common in one part of the world and totally absent in another. And it occurred to me listening to your mother that France was not a thought experiment, but an actual place filled with actual people whose traditions were different, whose lives really were different, whose sense of beauty was different. When I look back, I know that I was getting this message from all over. By that time, my friends included a great number of people with ties to different worlds. Make the race proud, the elders used to say to me, but by then I knew I wasn't biologically bound to any race as to a group of people. And these people were not black because of any uniform color or any uniform physical feature. They were bound because they suffered under the weight of the dream. And they were bound by all the beautiful things, all the language and mannerisms, all the food and music, all the literature and philosophy, all the common language which they fashioned like diamonds under the great weight of the dream. Not long ago, I was standing in an airport retrieving a bag from a conveyor belt. I bumped into a young black man and said, "My bag," without even looking. He said, "You straight." And in that exchange, there was so much of the private rapport that can only exist between two particular strangers of this tribe, which we call black. In other words, I was part of a world. And looking out, I had friends who too were part of other worlds, the world of Jews or of New Yorkers, the world of Southerners or gay men, of immigrants, of Californians, of Native Americans, or perhaps a combination of any and all of these worlds stitched into whole other worlds like a tapestry. And though I could never myself be a native to any of these worlds, I knew that nothing so essential, so ostensibly genetic as race stood between us. I had read too much by then, and my eyes, my beautiful, precious, essential eyes, were growing stronger each day. And I saw that which divided I and I from the world was not anything intrinsic to us, but the actual injury done by my people intent on naming us, intent on believing that what they have named us matters more than anything we could ever actually do. In America, the injury is not being born with darker skin, with fuller lips, with a broader nose, but in everything that happens after that. In that single exchange with that young man, I was speaking the personal language of my people. It was the briefest of intimacies, but it captured so much of the beauty of my world, the ease between your mother and I, the miracle at the Mecca, the way I feel myself disappearing into the streets of Harlem. To call that feeling racial is to hand over all those diamonds fashioned by our ancestors to the plunderer. We made that feeling. Though it was forged in the shadow of the murder, the rape, the disembodied, we made it all the same. This is the beautiful thing which I have seen with my own eyes, and I think I needed this vantage point before I could journey out. I think I needed to know I was from somewhere, that my home was as beautiful as any other. 7 years after I saw those pictures of those doors, I received my first adult passport. I am deeply ashamed that it took so long. I wish it had come sooner. I wish when I was back in that French class that I had connected the conjugations of verbs and gendered nouns to something grander. I wish someone had told me what the class really was, a gate to some other blue world. I wanted to see that world myself, to see the doors and everything behind them. The day of my departure, I sat in a restaurant with your mother, who showed me so much. I told her I am afraid. I didn't really speak the language. I did not know the customs. I would be alone. She just listened and held my hand. And that night, I boarded a starship. The starship punched out into the dark, punched through the sky, punched out past West Baltimore, punched out past Mecca, past New York, past any language and every spectrum known to me. My ticket took me to Geneva first. Everything happened so fast. I had to change money. I needed to find a train from the airport into the city, and after that, find another train to Paris. Some months earlier, I had begun a halting study of the French language. Now I was in a storm of French, drenched really, and only equipped to catch drops of the language. Who, euros, you, to the right. I was still very afraid. I surveyed the railway schedule and became aware that I was one wrong ticket away from Vienna, Milan, or some Alpine village that no one I knew had ever heard of. It happened right then, the realization of being far gone, the fear, the unknowable possibilities, all of it, the horror, the wonder, the joy, fused into an erotic thrill. The thrill was not wholly alien to me. It was close to the wave which had come over me in the library at Howard. It was kin to the narcotic shot I'd gotten watching the people with their wine glasses spill out onto West Broadway. It was all that I'd felt looking at those Parisian doors. And at that moment, I realized that those changes, with all their agony, awkwardness, and confusion, were the defining fact of my life. And for the first time, I knew not only that I was really alive, but that I really was studying and observing, and that I had always been alive, even back in Baltimore. I had always been living. I was always translating. I arrived in Paris. I checked into a hotel. I had no understanding of the local history at all. I didn't think much about Baldwin nor Wright. I had not read Sartre nor Camus, and if I walked past Café Le Fleur or Dumas Go, I did not then take any particular note. None of it mattered. It was Friday, and what mattered were the streets thronged with people in all their amazing configurations, teenagers together in their cafes, school children kicking a soccer ball on the street, backpacks to the side, older couples in their long coats, billows and blazers, 20-somethings leaning out of any number of establishments, looking beautiful and cool. It recalled New York, but without the low-grade, ever-present fear. The people wore no armor or none that I recognized. Side streets and alleys were bursting with bars, restaurants, and cafes. Everyone was walking. Those who were not walking were embracing. The next day, I got up and walked through the city. I visited Musée Rodin. I stopped in a bistro, and with all the fear of a boy approaching a beautiful girl at a party, I ordered 2 beers and then a burger. I walked to Le Jardin du Luxembourg. It was about 4 p.m. in the afternoon. I took a seat. The garden was bursting with people again in all their alien ways. At that moment, a strange loneliness took hold. Perhaps it was that I had not spoken a single word of English that entire day. Perhaps it was the fact that I had never sat in a public garden before, had not even known it to be something I'd want to do. And all around me, there were people who did this regularly. It occurred to me that I really was in someone else's country, and yet in some necessary way, I was outside of their country. In America, I was always a part of the equation, even if it wasn't a part I relished. I was the one the police stopped on 23rd Street in the middle of a working day. I was the one driven to Howard University. I was a father. I was a spouse. But sitting in that garden for the first time, I was an alien. I was a sailor, landless and disconnected. And I was sorry that I had never felt this particular loneliness before, that I had never felt myself so far outside of the dream of America. Now I felt the deeper weight of my generational chains, my body confined by history and policy to certain zones. Some of us make it out, but the game is played with loaded dice. I wished I had known more. I wished I had known it sooner. I remember that night watching the teenagers down on the pathway near the Seine, gathering to do all their teenage things. And I remember thinking how much I would have loved for that to have been my life, how much I would have loved to have a past apart from the fear. I did not have that past in hand, but I had you. We came back to Paris that summer because your mother loved the city and because I loved the language, but above all, we came back because of you. I wanted you to have your own life apart from fear, even apart from me. I am wounded. I am marked by old codes which shielded me in one world and chained me in the next. I think of your grandmother calling me and noting how you were growing tall and would one day try to test me. And I said to her that I would regard that day, should it come, as the total failure of my fatherhood, because if all I had over you were my hands, then I really had nothing at all. But forgive me, son, I knew what she meant. And when you were younger, I thought the same. And I am ashamed of that thought, ashamed of my fear, ashamed of my generational chains. We are entering into our last years together, and I wish I had been softer with you. Your mother had to teach me how to love you, how to kiss you, how to tell you I love you every night. Even now, it doesn't feel like a holy natural act so much as it feels like ritual. And that is because I am wounded. That is because I am tied to old ways which I learned in a hard house. It was a loving house, besieged by its country, but it was hard. And in Paris, I could not shake the old ways, the instinct to watch my back at every corner. A few weeks into our stay, I made a friend who wanted to improve his English as much as I wanted to improve my French. We met one day out in the crowd in front of Notre Dame. We walked to the Latin Quarter. We walked to a wine shop. Outside the wine shop, there was seating. We sat and drank a bottle of red. We were served heaping piles of meat, bread, and cheese. Was this dinner? Did people do this? I had not even known how to imagine it. And more, was this all some ritual, some elaborate ritual to get an angle on me? I thought, don't think shit is sweet because you're in Paris, Ta-Nehisi. My friend paid. I thanked him. But when we left, I made sure he walked out first. He wanted to show me one of those old buildings which seemed to be around every corner in that city. And the entire time he was leading me, I was sure he was going to make a quick turn into an alley where some dudes would be waiting to strip me of what exactly? And my new friend simply showed me the building, shook my hand, gave a fine bonsoir, and walked off into the wide open night. And watching him walk away, I knew that I had missed part of the experience because of my eyes, because my eyes were made in Baltimore, because my eyes were blindfolded by fear. What I wanted was to put as much distance between you and that blinding fear as possible. I wanted you to see different people living by different rules. I wanted you to see the couples sitting next to each other in the cafes, turned out to watch the street. The women pedaling their old bikes up the streets without helmets and long white dresses. The women whizzing past in Daisy Dukes and pink roller skates. I wanted you to see the men in salmon-colored pants and white linen and bright sweaters tied around their necks. The men who disappeared around corners and circled back in luxury cars with a top down, loving their lives. All of them smoking. All of them knowing that either grisly death or an orgy awaited them just around the corner. Do you remember how your eyes lit up like candles when we stood out on Saint-Germain-des-Prés? That was the look that I lived for. And even then, I wanted you to be conscious, to understand that to be distant, if only for a moment, from fear is not a passport out of the struggle. We will always be black, you and I, even if it means different things in different places. France is built on its own dream, on its own collection of bodies. And recall that your very name is drawn from a man who opposed the national robbery of colonization. It is true that our color was not our distinguishing feature there, so much as our Americanness represented and our poor handle on the language. And it is true that there is something particular about how these Americans who think they are white regard us, something sexual and obscene. We were not enslaved in France. We are not their particular problem. We are not their national guilt. We are not their niggers. If there is any comfort in this, it is not the kind which I would encourage you to indulge. Remember your name. Remember that you and I are brothers, are the children of transatlantic rape. Remember the broader consciousness that comes with that. Remember that this consciousness can never be racial, must always be cosmic. Remember the Roma you saw begging with their children in the street and the venom with which they were addressed. Remember the Algerian cab driver speaking openly of his hatred of Paris, then looking at your mother and I and insisting that we were all united under Africa. Remember the rumbling we all felt under the beauty of Paris, as though the city had been built in abeyance of Pompeii. Remember the feeling that the great public gardens, the long lunches, might all be undone by a physics cousin to our galaxy that we did not yet fully comprehend. I arrived at this broader world by the long winding route, but too I think I arrived with a force all my own. I did not die in my amorphous youth. I did not perish in the agony of not knowing. I was not jailed. I had proven to myself that there was another way beyond the schools and the streets. I felt myself to be among the survivors of some great natural disaster, some plague, some avalanche or earthquake. And now, living in the wake of a decimation and having arrived at a land which I once considered mythical, everything was cast in halo. The pastel Parisian scars burned a little brighter. The morning odor wafting out of the boulangeries was hypnotic, and all the language around me struck me not so much as language, but as dance. Your route will be different. It must be. You knew things at 11 that I did not know when I was 25. When I was 11, my highest priority was the simple security of my body. My life was the immediate negotiation of violence within my house and without. But already, you have expectations. I see that in you. Survival and safety are not enough for you. Your hopes, your dreams, if you will, leave me with an array of warring emotions. I am so very proud of you, your openness, your ambition, your aggression, your intelligence. My job in the little time we have left together is to match that intelligence with wisdom. Part of that wisdom is understanding what you were given. A city where gay bars are unremarkable, a soccer team where half the players speak some other language. What I am saying is that it does not all belong to you, that the beauty in you is not strictly yours and is largely the result of enjoying an abnormal amount of security in your black body. Perhaps that is why when you discovered the killer of Michael Brown would go unpunished, you told me you had to go. Perhaps that is why you were crying, because in that moment you understood that even your relatively privileged security can never match a sustained assault launched in the name of the dream. Our current politics tell you that should you fall victim to such an assault and lose your body, that it somehow must be your fault. Trayvon Martin's hoodie got him killed. Jordan Davis's loud music did the same. John Crawford should never have touched the rifle on display. Kajimi Powell should have known not to be crazy. And all of them should have had fathers. Even the ones who had fathers should have had fathers. Even you should have a father. Without its own justifications, the dream would collapse upon itself. The right to capture our bodies, built on the foundation of phrenology, is so ingrained that it is barely questioned. Even if the worst rendering of Michael Brown were true, the question behind the question is never asked. Should assaulting an officer of the state be a capital offense, rendered without trial with the officer as judge and executioner? Is that what we want civilization to be? And all the time, the dreamers are torturing Muslims, and their drones are bombing wedding parties, and the dreamers are quoting Martin Luther King and exalting nonviolence for the weak and maximum guns for the strong. Each time a police officer engages us, death, injury, maiming is possible. It is not enough to say this is true of anyone, or more true of criminals. The moment the officers began their pursuit of Prince Jones, his life was in danger. The dreamers accept this as the cost of doing business, accept our bodies as currency because it is their tradition. As slaves, we were the down payment. In redemption and reunion, we were their second mortgage. In the New Deal, we were their guest room and their finished basement. And today, with a sprawling prison system, which has turned the warehousing of black bodies into a job program for dreamers, into a lucrative investment for dreamers, when 8% of the world's prisoners are black men, our bodies have refinanced the dream of godhood. Black life is cheap. No, black life is a natural resource which matters more than anyone wants to know. Black life is precious metal, is the trove of gems, the cash of diamonds, the gold, the silver, which backs the dream of being white. Thank you.
The French Prime Minister recently said that France has its own form of apartheid. As a black man, do you still feel safe here?
Not like a part of like the crime here. You know, like the crime here is of colonization. That you know, forms a special relationship between France and people of France, for instance, West African descent, people from the Maghreb. Much like in America, there's a special relationship between black people who were enslaved there. It's a particular thing. And so I think I'm pretty sure about this. When people see me, they might think one thing, but when they hear me speak, you know, it occurs to them that I'm American. So I'm black, but I'm American, and that becomes like a kind of a different sheen. It's very similar actually in America. There's a whole sort of dialogue that goes, you know, about how West Indians are so much more hardworking than black people. And African immigrants are so much more hardworking and more, you know, intelligent or whatever than black people. And there's something particular about black people. So I think powers, in that country have a specific relationship with the people who have been oppressed within the boundaries of that country. Now, here's the thing. That's me, you know, like as giving my political analysis, right? At the same time, I think it's so very, very important that even as we notice, like, that we live as, like, human beings, that we still enjoy things, and that we still enjoy, you know, our nice bottle of wine. Because I think, like, one of the ultimate crimes of, you know, what white supremacy and racism does is it strips you of your ability to be human. You know, and you can walk around all day, like, thinking about this. You know, so I feel like, you know, I'm charged, you know, to convey to my son two things. One, a consciousness of history, right? Like, a consciousness that, you know, you didn't arrive in heaven all of a sudden, right? But you can also enjoy it too. You know, Eric Garner was killed in New York. I love New York. I still love New York. You know, like I'm aware that Eric Garner was killed there. And I'm aware what the NYPD is in New York. But I adore New York, you know, at the same way. And I think like I should adore New York. I think I've been thinking about this a lot lately, right? Like what we say when we're proud of a country, you know? Like, can I say, you know, I'm proud of America? I think the last time I was here, my answer was yes. And I'm beginning to think not so much. Well, let me rephrase that. I'm beginning to think like you can be proud culturally, but it's very hard to be proud of any country politically. You know, because what politics requires ultimately is the dispensation of death. I mean, that really is what the business of politics is about. You know, who's going to get what resources, and these matters are always of life and death. And that, you know, is never inseparable from particular prejudices and racism and et cetera. You know, for me, you know, as a black person, feeling like so much of my life is, you know, and as a writer, you know, given my business, feeling like so much of my life is at war, it is very, very important to live. Before we came here, I sat with my wife and had a nice drink in a very nice place. And that's like important, you know? And I want, you know, I want my son to get that, you know? It doesn't, you know, have to make, you know, Paris utopia. It doesn't have to make anywhere utopia. If anything, like the thing I'm trying to get across in the book is that that don't exist. You know, like you have to accept the fact that that's just not, you know, the world. And then you got to find some way to live with it as an individual and as, you know, some sort of, you know, policy person.
When you look at your son, do you see a generational progression in the U.S. with regard to race?
I ask myself that question all the time. There was probably individual progression. In my, like, if I looked at just my family, and I looked at my grandfather, through my father's side, if I looked at my grandfather, probably my mother's side, too, and I looked at my father, and I looked at me, and I looked at my son, I would say yes. But there are a number of statistics, you know, where if I, in other words, I would not expand that out. You know, and in fact, one of the challenges of writing this was to write to him as an individual and to somehow balance that with the fact that he was in the middle of something else. You know, and that's what I, even at the end of what I just read, I was trying to get across to him, listen, like, you're privileged. You know, even as a black person, like, you're kind of lucky. You know what I mean? And you should always, like, be clear on that. You shouldn't think that, like, this is normal. You know, he probably doesn't. You know, in fact, I know he doesn't. I don't know. That's a long way of saying, you know, I don't know. Because they're like these obvious things, right? Like, oh, you know, lynching has declined, you know, lynching didn't really happen and we don't have, you know, certain signs. But there are a bevy of socioeconomic statistics, you know, which I went through in the case for reparations that make, a, you know, a counter case. You know, I mean, the wealth gap is you know, like a huge argument, you know, that no, there's not been progress. You know, the lines of segregation, and, you know, the fact that African Americans are still the most segregated, you know, community in the country and have, you know, have been, you know, for most of American history, you know, is still a... it makes a case that no, you know? And then, like, you have to balance that against, like, maybe there's been progress for black people, right? But what if there's been more progress for white people? I mean, the real question is the gap. So if this person is moving at 60 miles an hour, right, and you're moving at 20, I mean, you progressed, but did you progress relative to everybody else in your country? So the honest answer is I don't know. I don't know. It's a hard thing. It's a very, very hard thing.
You mentioned being interviewed by a cable news channel where, because of how the host reacted, you felt you failed in making your point. How did you fail exactly?
This picture that was like going viral on Facebook and probably not very many black people's Facebook, but it's Facebook. And it was after Michael Brown. It's this young black kid who's hugging this cop, right? Which is cool. I mean, I'm obviously not against, you know, young black kids hugging cops. I think that's great. But it was like, her question was, is this, you know, does this give us, is this a sign of progress? And it was such a, like, a misunderstanding of how deep, like, the cancer goes, you know? It was, and again, you know, I talked about this last time I was here, it was just like this notion of, well, if they can be nice to each other, maybe everything will be okay. You know, like, if manners can be improved between the police and the cops, everything will be okay. You know, it was just such a, and it was, well, I knew I had failed. I know I failed. You know, the fact that she would ask that question, you know, demonstrated that I had failed.
Yeah. Who was it?
I was on Face the Nation with Nora O'Donnell. I'm sorry, Nora O'Donnell. I debated over writing that and not writing that. She was very nice. She was very, very nice and very kind. Yes.
As a writer, do you see yourself as a kind of link between the previous generation and the new one?
It's very, writing is very, very hard. And I try to stay within the pages. And I'm a writer. I'm very, very, like, you know, big on just, you know, being just a writer. And of all of the things that you know, say are happening, I'm very happy that they're happening. I'm very pleased by that. But I can't really write in with that intent. In fact, if I did write with that intent, everything you're saying happens probably wouldn't happen because everybody would see it. It would be obvious that that's what I was trying to be. You know, so I try to keep the writing pure and just, you know, just make it come from here. And if that happens, that's great.
You are an avid video game player along with your son. How does that fit into your thoughts and writing about race?
Things that I think I think, would be true about me, were I black or not. And those things are very important. And I may talk about, I'm forced, I have to, because who I am, talk about those things through being black. But it's like asking me, it's exactly like asking me, do you like Johnny Walker Black because you're black? I mean, it's sort of like that kind of question. Like, there are all sorts of things that I like, that I really do like Johnny Walker Black, right? I do, right? Like, there are all sorts of things, you know. You know, do you like your steak cooked a certain way because you're black? You know, like, there are all sorts of decisions that I would make, you know, regardless. So, I mean, I think, like, those things, and I think, you know, to the extent that it's tied to this, even, you know, my experience here, you know, reflect some things that are just bone deep about me. You know, a large part of, like, black, in terms of, like, as a racial condition, as understood as it's something that other people put on you. Now, the community is real. The language is real, you know, all the rituals between that's real. That's something that the people themselves create. But, you know, like, as a political identity, it's, you know, it's largely, you know, something that's put upon me. And, you know, I'm very aware that, you know, like, if I, you know, had, I don't know, grown up somewhere else, it's very difficult to imagine where that world would be now, you know, given, you know, the you know, what the world is like. But had I grown up in another time, in another place, I think I would still like certain things. And I think it's very, very important to say that, because if we don't, you know, we sort of concede some part of ourselves. And I hate that. You know, I really, really sort of, it's one of the burdens of this, you know. And if I want anything for the kid, it's like, you know, to not have to concede that. Like, you know, you can be political and go to war and do what you got to do. But when you come home, it's okay to love certain things. It's okay. It's all right. You don't have to justify it. You know, it's normal. In fact, it's an argument for why you're human. You know, and not just a robot, you know, an android sitting out there to fight a war.